Thank you, Dr. Zhang. Thank you for all who are in attendance today. Thank you for Dr. Septiatora Thompson, Dr. Buckworth, Dr. Leoki, all of my colleagues, Dr. Evans. Honored and so excited to be back in Athens. As Dr. Zhang mentioned, my PhD studies were here in Athens, so for all of you who are doctoral students, you're at an excellent and a very special place. Everything that I've accomplished in my career is based on the foundation that I've received not only here, but through my family, through my undergraduate and my master's studies. So one thing that I'll start off my keynote speech with, which will tie into some of the themes that I'll talk about in my work, and hopefully you'll see some intersections with things that you're working on, is for everyone to think about three C's that are important for you personally and professionally. One, what are you convicted by? What are your convictions? And when we talk about, particularly in society today, around social justice efforts, around activism, around advocacy, we want to think about what are you convicted by? As it relates to your convictions, I want you to think about what are you courageous about? Courageous. Because you can be convicted, but you also have to take the step to be courageous in the face of backlash, in the face of counter-resistance, in the face of oppression. And then the last C that I want you all to think about is, what are you committed to? So when you think about your convictions, what you're courageous about, and what you're committed to, that will connect to what your core values are and ultimately your mission. I'm honored today to present a forthcoming piece. A forthcoming book that will be coming out this winter, and I'm really excited to share this work with you all, and I think that particularly the themes of the text will help connect us internationally as well. So you'll hear me make international references throughout the presentation. So when we think about within the United States as a contested terrain, we have to remember that the United States is a neo-colonial capitalist state, which means that the foundations of the country were built on the enslavement of African people, the genocide of indigenous people, and other human rights violations. Contrary to popular belief, those involved in sport historically have never just been passive observers of the world around them. They've been active resistors against this oppression. So when we look at the screen here, many of us are familiar with Colin Kaepernick and his taking a knee in 2016, bringing attention to police brutality, not only against African Americans, but against people who are economically disadvantaged in our society. But Colin Kaepernick's taking a knee is a part of a lineage and a legacy of African American athletes taking a stand. In the center, we see the Ali Summit, which occurred in 1967, when Muhammad Ali famously declined a draft into the military to fight into the Vietnam War. Muhammad Ali is one of the foremost activist athletes in the 20th century. He used his platform to ignite change, even so much as so to give up his heavyweight title at the peak of his career because he was convicted, he was courageous, and he was committed to human rights for all people. Many of you are familiar with the iconic image of Tommy Smith and John Carlos in the Mexico City Olympics in 1968, where they raised their fists, they had their jackets unzipped, and they were wearing beads as well as they were barefoot to signify their solidarity with individuals in the United States who were being oppressed based on their race and their class. Many people may not remember Peter Norman, the Australian runner, who is standing right next to them, also wore a pin in showing his solidarity with the Olympic Project for Human Rights, hence showing the international coalition building for human rights. Also historically, Dr. Edwin Bancroft Henderson, the gentleman that you see on your left, he is considered the founder of black basketball, learned the game from James Naismith, spread the game of basketball in Washington, D.C., was instrumental in creating some of the initial archival texts about Negroes in sport. So prior to 1947, when Jackie Robinson broke the color barrier, sports were racially segregated within the United States. So African Americans had to create their own leagues, their own associations, their own institutions. Paul Robeson, who I would argue is the foremost activist, athlete, scholar of any generation. He used his platform to champion human rights, even challenging the United States government, so much so that his passport was revoked and he was not able to return to the United States for an extended period of time. And then Wilma Rudolph, one of the standout African-American female track and field athletes, who after winning gold medals in the 1960 Olympics in Rome, came back to her hometown in Clarksville, Tennessee, which was still racially segregated, and told her their town politicians that I am not going to participate in a parade if it's going to be racially segregated. Due to her conviction, her courage, and her commitment, within 2 weeks, all the restaurants and public facilities within Clarksville, Tennessee were desegregated. She used her platform and her status as an athlete to ignite change. Dr. Tina Sloan Green, the founder of the Black Women in Sports Foundation, has been committed to providing opportunities for young Black girls to participate in traditionally white sports. Oftentimes, less access is provided to Black girls in sports like tennis, lacrosse, field hockey within the United States. So she's been a champion for social justice in that way. Maya Moore, one of the most decorated basketball players across all genders of all time, used her platform to step away from the game of basketball as a multi-time professional champion to fight for who's now her husband, a Black man who was wrongfully convicted for a life sentence. He had already served nearly 20 years in prison. Due to her advocacy and her championing legal activism, she was able to get his case overturned. And then John B. McClendon, one of the leaders of Black basketball, won 3 National Athletic Association championships in 1957, 1958, and 1959, during a period where the stereotype was Blacks were innately athletically gifted, but intellectually inferior to be coaches and to be leaders. He challenged that dominant stereotype and is in the Basketball Hall of Fame today. LeBron James, many of you know, has engaged in hybrid resistance. Not only has he created his own school in Akron, Ohio, to help children who have experienced academic challenges in traditional schooling spaces, but he's also created a myriad of businesses to engage in what I'll talk about later as economic activism. Allison Felix, decorated Olympic track and field athlete, after she was pregnant, Nike threatened to remove her endorsement deal. She filed a lawsuit against Nike saying that that was discrimination based on her sex and her pregnancy status. Due to her activism, Nike has rearranged and reworded their contracts so that individuals who are pregnant are not penalized financially. And then Ed O'Bannon, through his courage, his conviction, his courage and commitment, he challenged the National Collegiate Athletic Association so that college athletes could have access to their name, image, and likeness. The Fair Pay to Play Act in California that has been passed, which will be enacted in a few years, is because of the activism and leadership of Ed O'Bannon. So why do I say all this? In this text, I want to highlight that Blacks in the United States and internationally have utilized sport as a space to challenge mainstream ideologies and oppressive conditions. So I'm going to introduce concepts that I hope many of you will think about critically. A part of our education through not only here at UGA, but in various educational spaces, is to think critically about the world we live in and think about ways in which we can change it for the better. Not accepting things on the face value. Historically, athlete activism has been viewed and talked about from an athlete-centric perspective. One of the terms that I'm introducing in this piece is sport activism. Athletes are a prominent part of sports, but there are individuals connected to sport, such as many of us in this room, as sports scholars, coaches, administrators, spectators, volunteers, who are connected to sport, who utilize their platforms to ignite change. So it's not just about the athletes themselves. The purpose of this presentation, although it centers on African Americans, I'm hoping that the typologies that I present, you will be able to identify and see. My colleagues and I are working on 2 separate pieces, one looking at international activism and how the typology that will be presented to you today manifests itself in international spaces. And then another piece that we're looking at is specifically Black internationalism and resistance through sport. So in this piece, I look at intergenerational and intragenerational resistance actions through race, ethnicity-centric typologies, and interdisciplinary theories to show how sport has been used by individuals, groups, and organizations and institutions to express their humanity, preserve cultural heritages, empower themselves and their communities, project political views, and pursue freedom, equality, and justice. So a brief historical overview of African-American resistance in the United States. Starting in the 1600s, prior to the founding of the country was founded in 1776, but European colonizers, through the transatlantic atrocity, I don't use the term slave trade, once again, I begin to enact in my work challenging the language that is used. The individuals who were enslaved were not slaves, they were subject to enslavement. They were powerful individuals, powerful African people who were subject to enslavement. But between the 1600s to the 1890s, it was what was coined as the Black liberation struggle. So at this time, you have to keep in mind, Blacks were codified through law as property. That means they were treated worse than animals, right? Want us to think about that. For multiple centuries, Black human beings who had hearts, brains, feelings, thoughts, were subject to being treated as property. Could be sold, could be raped, could be killed. So the Black liberation struggle through a range of tactics focused on promoting that humanity and accomplishing freedom from that. At the turn of the century, after the Emancipation Proclamation and post-Reconstruction era, it became this era that was coined the New Negro Era. The New Negro Era described African Americans who were born after the Emancipation Proclamation and were beginning to experience new beginnings within the Americas, particularly within political spaces, within economic spaces, educational spaces, and yes, you guessed it, within sporting spaces. Between the 1960s and 1980s, the civil rights movement, Black power, and Black feminist movements informed not only how African Americans were championing for human rights within the United States, but also building international coalitions, such as the All-African Revolutionary Party, led by Kwame Ture. In the 1980s to 2000s, it's what's coined as the hip-hop movement. Oftentimes, we overlook that period because we compare the mass mobilization that was taking place in the civil rights and saying that it all went away after the civil rights legislations. But as I'll mention here briefly, from a critical race theory standpoint, racism is a permanent feature of the United States. So the idea that as long as racism has been permanent, there's always been counter-resistance against that racism, and specifically anti-Black racism. And then more recently, we are in the Black Lives Matter era, where widespread police brutality against African Americans on camera has been pervasive. There have been multiple marches that have been taking place, and in many cases, individuals connected to sport have been a part of that. So in my work, I champion using theoretical pluralism. I know we have our disciplines, whether it's sociology, political science, kinesiology, business, but I argue that we are holistic individuals and we learn more when we engage in interdisciplinary analytical tools. So within my work, I talk about Dr. Harry Edwards' Four Ways of Black Athlete Activism, which I'll describe momentarily. I use critical race theory and the tenets of CRT that help inform understanding social relations. I incorporate Boykin's 9 interrelated dimensions of African American culture, which are spirituality, harmony, movement, verve, affect, communalism, expressive individualism, oral tradition, and social time perspective. And then within this text, I introduce an African American sport activism typology. Historically, when we've talked about activism, we only focus on protests and boycotts, which are what we call public demonstrative activist acts. But activism manifests itself in a multitude of ways, which I'll be presenting momentarily. In addition, Aside from activism, there's a broader encompassing term that I use in my work that talks about resistance. You can engage in social change even when you're not engaging in an activist act. One of the challenges that we've had in our society is we begin to dilute powerful terms and powerful tools that can be used to disrupt oppression. For example, we use activism and exploitation to describe instances that are not necessarily activism and exploitation. And I'll describe that later in the presentation. And then I'm going to introduce the complexity of resistance through Black existentialism philosophies. All that means is that African Americans, people of African descent, people of any diaspora are not monolithic. And the ways in which they have pursued change vary. Everybody doesn't have a race-centric approach. Everybody doesn't have a class-based approach. Everybody doesn't have an intersectionality approach. But many of these groups are fighting for similar aims, and it's important to honor the heterogeneity among those efforts. In regards to Dr. Harry Edwards, arguably, in my mind, the founder of sports sociology in the United States, he introduced this four waves of Black athlete activism. First wave from the 1900s to 1940s focused on gaining legitimacy. So when we think of Jesse Owens winning four gold medals in the 1936 Olympics in Berlin during the height of Adolf Hitler's Nazism campaign, so it was very disruptive, not only from a nationalistic standpoint, but very much from a racial domination standpoint, right? Having this Black athlete go to Germany and defeat athletes of Aryan descent was very much a blow to the myth of Nazism. The second wave of Black athlete activism focused on acquiring political access and positional diversity. This is when Jackie Robinson broke the color barrier in men's Major League Baseball, when Althea Gibson became the first African-American woman to win the Wimbledon tennis tournament in the late 1950s, when you saw an influx of African-Americans gaining access to historically white institutions in the athletic programs. In the third wave, demanding dignity and respect focused on using mass mobilization and grassroots activism. Dr. Edwards argues from the 1970s to 2005 that there was a period of Black athlete stagnation. I argue that it wasn't so much a stagnation, it was an evolution of resistance that took place in the post-civil rights era. And then the fourth wave focused on securing and transferring power via economic and technological capital, which has been spearheaded by Black sports persons such as LeBron James, Venus, and Serena Williams, to name a few. Critical race theory is a theory that argues that racism is endemic in all institutions and in the pathologies of individuals who have occupied neo-colonial spaces. So even if you are unintentionally perpetuating racism, you're born in a society where racism has been embedded. Right? I'll give you an example. When I was here at UGA, some of the racism that I experienced from a microaggression standpoint. When I would be walking to class in Ramsey, oftentimes I would get the question, are you an athlete here? Right? The idea was, because I'm a Black male, there's no reason why I would be at this institution unless I was on the football, basketball, or track and field team. Racism is endemic. How many of you, when you think about some of the curriculums in your K-12 schooling, learned about Afrocentric education, right? Racism is endemic in our experiences. If we look at the Institute for Diversity and Ethics in Sport, the racial and gender report card for the past two decades, and we see sports that, even though from a participant standpoint, are comprised of a majority of African Americans, but from a coaching, management, and ownership standpoint, it could be anywhere from 3% to 0%. Racism is endemic within our society. So I use critical race theory and its tenets to help inform how social change manifests itself, particularly interest convergence, where the idea that any advancements of a group that is disadvantaged only occur insofar as it benefits the dominant group or the group that is in power, right? Counter stories. Within my text, I highlight the perspectives of groups who are facing the oppression. For example, if you are a group that's facing oppression, you wouldn't describe it as white supremacy. You would describe it as white racism. right? Because there's nothing supreme about individuals taking your human dignity. There's nothing supreme about certain rights being withheld from you and then other groups being able to gain benefits. That is an unequal arrangement that has nothing to do with supremacy or even, I argue, social Darwinism, right? It has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with intentional power usage and leverages. In terms of Black existentialism, historically, African Americans have had different philosophies by which they champion advancement for the race. So classic liberal proponents such as Booker T. Washington, Thomas Sowell, William Julius Wilson focus more on class-based analysis. So as opposed to centralizing race as the main anchor for igniting change, you focused on other social identities and other resources, whether it be agriculture, whether it be accommodation and gradualism. Race-centric proponents such as W.B. Du Bois, Frederick Douglass, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., particularly during the formative stages and his involvement with the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, Bernard Boxall, say that racism and focusing on addressing racism will have a multiplier effect on other injustices in society. But until we address the racism that is pervasive in society, it's difficult to address classism, sexism, ageism, ableism, homophobia, and xenophobia. So within this text I'm presenting to you all, and I hope this stimulates your mind, this is the part that I get really excited about, because when I was talking to my colleagues and doc students, we were really exchanging ideas about why do we think certain ways of igniting change are more effective than others. I started to go through my mind and think about, well, the idea is that there's a range of ways in which change can happen, and depending on the time, space, and context, will influence the effectiveness of the efforts. So previous scholars have tried to delineate activism in different ways, and so I'm building on that work. I define activism, I'm not going to read that definition, but what I will provide to you all is five criteria for activism. And I think it's important that we define it, because if we don't define it, Huey P. Newton said, power is the ability to define phenomena and be able to help it act in a designed manner. So what that means is that if you're not able to accurately define something, it is subjected to be co-opted by forces that are seeking to dominate you. So I define activism with my colleagues as, one, it has to have intentionality for a collective aim. If I individually took a knee right now in the middle of this lecture, but I only did it for my own personal reasons, I didn't have a broader message, it would not be activism. It would be an agentic act. It could be agentic resistance or agency, but it wouldn't be activism unless I intentionally am doing it for a collective aim. Another criteria of activism is that there has to be a clear opposition. It could be in the form of a government. It could be in the form of an opposing force. It could be in oppose of an opposing entity. But there has to be an opposition. That's what delineates activism from advocacy. If all of us came together right now and said we wanted to bring money together to donate to the Children's Hospital, all of us wanted to run for a particular event to benefit children with autism, by and large, that would not get a lot of resistance. But if we were to say, hey, we're going to organize an event to promote anti-war efforts, anti-militarism, to promote anti-Black racism, to promote anti-sexism, we would get some pushback, right? So there would be some oppositional forces to that. Activism also has to have disruption and challenging of hegemonic systems. So there has to be some type of disruption, and that can be measured in a multitude of ways, working with colleagues to find quantitative ways to measure disruption. There have to be explicit aims and demands, right? So we can disrupt something, we can champion for a group of people, but if we don't have specific demands, then it's not activism. And then it has to be connected to a broader social movement. One broader intergenerational social movement that applies to all social justice efforts is the human rights social movement. And that preceded the establishment of the Universal Declaration for Human Rights. So in terms of the typology that I'll be presenting to you all, a couple ways that it's delineated is, to sum up what you see on the screen here, is that we delineated the activism based on the modality. based on the method used to engage in the disruptive act for social justice. The nine categories of the sport activism typology are symbolic, scholarly, grassroots, mass mobilization, economic, legal, media, music and art, and military. This is not an exhaustive list of activism. Keep in mind, this typology was grounded on research on African American sportspersons. So there are other areas that we mentioned or that I mentioned in the text that are not extensive within this particular group, but that could be found in other groups, such as civic activism, environmental activism, health activism, and religious activism. But remember, we're focused on the modality or the method by which the change is occurring, as opposed to the purpose. Symbolic activism focuses on engaging in a public demonstrative act. That's the one that many of us are most familiar with. Tommy Smith and John Carlos raising their fists, Colin Kaepernick taking a knee, Black Lives Matter protests. Scholarly activism is one that we're less familiar with. When we think about the work that each of us do in our respective disciplines, any social movement is undergirded by some level of intellectual foundation. You have to have data, empirical data, theoretical information, insights that guide some of the philosophies that you're seeking to incorporate. Scholarly activism is extremely important. Paradigm shift not only on the grassroots level, but they also shift in academic spaces, right? When new ideas are introduced, when people begin to think about things in different ways. Grassroots activism focuses on change that happens at a proximal or local level. Many of the college athlete-led protests nationally over the past several years are examples of grassroots activism, one of the most famous ones being at the University of Missouri in 2015. Mass mobilization activism is an example of that would be the Olympic Project for Human Rights. So mass mobilization differs from grassroots because mass mobilization focuses on international and interstate mobilization efforts. So it moves beyond a particular local area and speaks to international. Economic activism focuses on divestment from oppressive entities as well as investment in empowering entities. So the idea of creating your own leagues, the Negro leagues before Jackie Robinson broke the color barrier were an example of economic activism, right? Legal activism. Many of the changes that we've seen in our society within the United States, whether it be Title IX, whether it be the Civil Rights Movement, Brown v. Board of Education, Emancipation Proclamation, all of that involved legal activism. Media activism, not only through social media, but also through historically in the 1900s through the 1950s, radio and newspaper were extremely influential in igniting social change. Music and art activism. I would argue music and art activism have shifted cultural, social, and political changes internationally in ways that match any other form of activism. And then military activism, which not only involves instances such as tactical guerrilla warfare, but also involvement in the military. Many people don't know that Jackie Robinson and Arthur Ashe were involved in the military and engaged in activist acts while they were doing their service. So many people remember Muhammad Ali declining to enter into the military, but Jackie Robinson and Arthur Ashe agreed to be in the military, and once they experienced racism within that space, they exercised their agency to challenge the militaristic norms. So this is just a chart. The font is a little bit small, but just know that there are delineations based on the intent, the level of consciousness, whether the issue was within and beyond sport. So I use the phrase in and through sport to describe when you're engaging in resistance and activism in sport, you're changing rules and norm within a sporting space that could have a ripple effect. In 2007, Venus Williams challenged the gender inequity pay at the Wimbledon tennis tournament, building on the legacy of Billie Jean King. And she was successful in making sure that women and men had equal prize money. Ironically and poetically, in 2007, she won the Wimbledon tennis tournament. So she became the first woman in the Wimbledon tennis tournament to earn equal prize money to men. So she was engaging in that type of activism within sport that led to change. Many of the activist acts that come to mind are those that are through sport. So when Muhammad Ali is using his platform to say that we shouldn't fight in the Vietnam War, when he's saying that there's racism that needs to be addressed within the United States, he's not trying to change the World Boxing Organization. He's not trying to change the Olympics. He's trying to change society abroad, but he's using his platform through sport to ignite change. So within my text, I have a chapter specifically on resistance and activism in sport, desegregating leagues, changing leadership policies, and then I have another chapter focused on resistance and activism through sport. So this is just an additional chart here that I'll just skim through. Resistance is, so when you think of activism, remember how I mentioned that it was intentional. Resistance can be unintentional. A great example within sport where resistance is unintentional is when Allen Iverson during the early 2000s wore his hair in cornrows, wore his tattoos, and wore clothes that challenged the dominant norm of what a professional athlete should look like. Now, Allen Iverson wasn't trying to say that all black people should be able to wear their clothes like this, all white people, all Asian, all those of Latinx descent or of Hispanic descent or indigenous people or multiracial people. Allen Iverson was simply just expressing his own individuality. But through that resistance, he ruptured a norm within sport. He challenged the idea that you have to wear a suit and tie to engage in professional behavior, right? So this idea of resistance can happen in intentional and unintentional ways. One of the distinctions I make in the text is that activism also includes a delineation with borderline activist acts. Agency, advocacy, and pioneering are what I call borderline activism, which means under certain conditions they can be activism, in other conditions they're not. So for example, Jackie Robinson breaking the color barrier, that is activism as a pioneer. Michael Jordan becoming the first billionaire athlete is not activism, right? Now, it doesn't mean that Michael Jordan doesn't engage in certain activist acts, but the act of acquiring that kind of wealth within a capitalist system is not counter-hegemonic. And we could talk more about that if we have time for Q&A. So resistance has 8 categories. So we gave you an overview of the activism typology, different ways in which activism manifests itself. But I want you to think about resistance and how it applies to you and how it applies in international spaces. Agency is the use of personal choice and cultural dispositions to express certain political and social cultural views. Pioneering is when you're the first of your particular identities to accomplish a particular aim. Advocacy involves championing some type of human rights issue, but it doesn't necessarily meet all the 5 criteria of activism that were highlighted earlier. Hybrid resistance is what I argue many of us, if not all of us, engage in. All of us are not activists on every issue. Some of us are advocates, some of us are allies, some of us use our agency, and some of us use activism in certain ways. That is an example of hybrid resistance, whereby it's not one particular way in which you orient yourself in particular situations. When activism is mobilized, it turns into a social movement. Protracted social movements lead to revolutions, social transformations, and then those successful revolutions turn into sustained cultural empowerment. So when we think about the international implications, when several African countries started gaining their independence during the 19th and 20th century, my father, homeland of Liberia, Ghana, right, Algeria, several of these African countries, even South Africa, winning over anti-apartheid efforts, even though there's still ongoing battles against neo-colonial forces, that would be an example of sustained empowerment, right? The idea that at least the previous regime of colonial control has been fractured and there's been an infusion of a resistance against those forces. So once again, I provide some examples here. I apologize for the small font. Just to conclude my remarks, and hopefully maybe we'll have some time for Q&A. In chapter 3 of the text, I go back historically to look at complexity and contingency. So I highlight borderline activism and hybrid resistance within sport. So talk about this idea of what does it mean to be American nationalist in the sense of Jesse Owens, Joe Louis, Althea Gibson, Arthur Ashe, and the idea of what W.E.B. Du Bois coined as this dual consciousness, this double consciousness, having these conflicting identities that exist within an oppressive space. I also highlight hybrid resistance. Many of you may not be familiar with the Philadelphia Tribunes, the Georgetown, the Germantown Hornets, Bennett College Bells, historically black colleges and universities that engaged in hybrid resistance through sport. In chapter four, one of the unique contributions that I try to make to the field is delineating activism based on when it occurred at the youth and interscholastic level, the intercollegiate level, and at the professional level. I also have a whole section that focuses on African-American sportswomen, which historically African-American sportswomen's contributions to activism literature and sport has been largely marginalized. Chapter five, as I mentioned, focuses on resistance in sport, so changing social norms within sporting spaces through grassroots and mass mobilization activism, media activism, symbolic activism, and legal and economic activism. Chapter six focuses on resistance beyond the game, so resistance through sport, through scholarly activism, grassroots activism, music and art activism, economic, media, and military activism. So international, intergenerational, and global implications. Dating back to ancient African civilization through the pre-antebellum physical activities among people of African descent, these activities are often connected to spirituality, cultural values, and communal empowerment. Always remember who organizes, who sponsors, and structures the sporting space influences the meaning, the purpose, and the benefits derived from it. So ownership over the activities, the agency exhibited within that space. So historically, for those of African descent, sport was never about just leisure and entertainment. It was always connected to a cultural ethos. It was always connected to a level of humanity, a level of benefiting the larger collective. Whereas in other spaces, for example, in certain Eurocentric spaces, it's been viewed as a space for commodification, exploitation, and not just along racial lines, along sex lines. Keep in mind, women were excluded from sport largely throughout the 18th, 19th, and not until the early 20th century, right? The first African-American woman to win Olympic gold medal didn't happen until 1948. There were large sexist stereotypes that said certain types of physical activity were inappropriate for women to engage in because it would be detrimental to their bodies. So this isn't just the racial, this is where the global implications come into play. Black liberation struggle through the pre-antebellum and Reconstruction era primarily focused on agentic and cultural resistance. Because there was a lack of economic rights, there was a lack of political rights, agency and cultural resistance were prominent. During the New Negro movement, which I call the golden era of African-American sport resistance, organizational, institutional, and economic activism were the primary modes of resistance. This is why it's important to study resistance and activism intergenerationally across time, space, and context, because you see in different eras, different modalities and strategies were employed based on available resources and strategic decisions. During the civil rights, black power, and black feminist era, which is called the golden era of black athlete activism, remember I called the 1900s to 1950s the golden era of African-American sport resistance. So not just athlete, but sport and resistance, whereas the 1960s and 70s was the golden era of black athlete activism, focused on grassroots, mass mobilization, symbolic media activism, and hybrid resistance. During the hip-hop movement era from the 1980s to early 2000s, agentic and multi-issue focused resistance was primarily race-centric in nature. So when we think about the Fab Five, the Michigan Fab Five in the early 1990s and their resistance efforts, Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf of the Denver Nuggets, Craig Hodges, these individuals were challenging political norms that were grounded in oppression even though it wasn't in the same mass mobilization fashion as the civil rights era. And then in the Black Lives Matter era, there's been a resurgence of grassroots mass mobilization, symbolic and social media activism. In chapter 7, I provide recommendations for the future of African American resistance in and through sport. I talk about this importance of what my colleagues, soon to be Dr. Jolly, soon to be Dr. Dexter, are working on as well, is this idea of socialization from an early age. From childhood, adolescence, to early adulthood and adulthood, there needs to be a challenge to this idea that sports is an apolitical space. Sports is inherently political. Silence is a political act. Passiveness is a political act. I tell my students every day, you change the world through your actions and your inactions every day. What you fight for, what you don't fight for. What you're convicted by, what you're not convicted by. What you're courageous about, what you're not courageous about. What you're committed to, what you're not committed to, influences the world every day. So I propose this idea of resistance socialization. It shouldn't take till somebody gets to a PhD program to learn about Paul Robeson, E.B. Henderson, Althea Gibson, Wilma Rudolph, right? C. Vivian Stringer. Young athletes, sports persons, or what I call holistic athletes, should be introduced to these individuals at an early age. Economic grassroots and mass mobilization activism have to be amplified. I do argue for a pan-African revolution, right? So we move beyond this tribalism and this idea that because of certain different experiences with neo-colonial forces, certain different cultural norms, and even certain different political views, that there should be a level of not necessarily uniformity. A quote that was very famous during the Black liberation struggle in the 60s and 70s was unity without uniformity, right? So we can have a common goal without going about it in the same way, hence the use of the typologies that are presented in this text. Social media activism has to be important in the 21st century, and then more targeted and effective resistance efforts. So I'll conclude. Dr. Zhang mentioned the first text, From Exploitation Back to Empowerment, which focused on Black male holistic underdevelopment through sport and miseducation, the text that did inform this second text, because within this text, there's a model called the holistic empowerment model, which focuses on cultivating activist mindsets among young holistic individuals involved in sport. How does that manifest itself, and what would the world look like when all athletes begin to use their platform to ignite positive social change? So I want to thank you all for your time, and I'm not sure if there's time for Q&A, but thank you all again for attending this session, and I look forward to engaging in conversations with everyone after. Thank you.
Morning, Dr. Cooper. Glad to have you back. I'm curious, and it may be one of the foundational concepts, other theories, but how you tease out this, I'm trying to think how to really say this, but how through the, I guess almost the introspection that happens when activism occurs or this resistance occurs, that individuals of the African descent do this historical reflection, mm-hmm. And how that impacts their decisions to engage in some sort of activism. I'm not sure if you tease that out or what your thoughts are on that.
No, I think that's an excellent point. You know, I argue that historically, herstorically, and queerstorically, the ways in which all of us experience the world is different, right? Where you grow up, what community you grew up in, the interactions that took place, the way you even make sense of certain types of activism are varied. And I argue that's a strength. I think one of the problems that we have, not only in our scholarly literature, but within society more broadly, is that we look to simplify complex realities. And I argue that if we acknowledge the heterogeneity, in concert with what Audre Lorde said several decades ago, it's not our differences that divide us, it's our inability to celebrate, respect, and invalidate, I'm paraphrasing here, our differences. So what I would argue is that everyone's individuality and their uniqueness is a special and unique skill that is needed in our society. There's certain things that everyone in this room based on your lived experiences, your idiosyncrasies, your personalities, your philosophies. There are ways in which you can ignite change in spaces that some of us cannot, right? So it's the idea of the charge is, individually, how are you exercising your convictions, your courage, and your commitment to ignite change? Some of my white colleagues, the ways in which they go about promoting anti-racism is going to be different than mine. Some of my female counterparts, some of my transgender counterparts, the way that they go about championing anti-sexism and anti-trans phobia will be different than mine. But the idea is that we can be in concert with the ultimate goal of human rights, right? So I think that's a very important point that you raise. A part of what I think is important is not only a rereading of history, her story, and queer story, but an expansive reading of history, her story, and queer story. The idea is that if you're limited to a certain body of knowledge, your imagination can only go so far. So if I only give you one text to read, you're going to be influenced by that text. So everything you've experienced in that text. But if I give you this text, I give you this text from another author from another global perspective, this text from another author from another global perspective, now you have a more multifaceted understanding, so you're not limited to a simplistic, monolithic view of what actually took place. So I think that heterogeneity is important. Matter of fact, it's necessary. I think uniqueness is important and it's necessary. When we talk about diversity and inclusion, the reasons why spaces tend to thrive better when there's diversity and inclusion is because we all have certain lenses that are limited based on our experiences and backgrounds. But together, we can cover more bases. We can cover more topics. None of us is a scholar on everything. None of us is an expert on everything. But when you have a diverse group of people, when you have an inclusive space that's welcoming, that's when real change happens. And that's when you begin to break down stereotypes, break down biases, break down oppressive structures that are normalized, right? Many people don't even ask questions as to, well, you know, why do we say white supremacy? Like who came up with that? Why do we say disabilities, which is a term I don't use, right? I say individuals with unique abilities, because I can't think of any word in the human language that dis is associated with a positive connotation. So why would we attribute that to an ability? But that only happens when you have inclusive spaces. So hopefully that answers your question some.